The views expressed on this episode of My Take Radio do not reflect the views, thoughts, or feelings of the My Take Radio staff, My Take Radio advertisers, or My Take Radio content partners. Listener and viewer discretion is advised.
This coverage is live and uncensored, so if you have any small children present, you may want to have them leave the room.
What's up, guys? My Take Radio episode 344, powered by RageWorks, broadcasting live Thursday, March 23rd, 2016. I'm your host, Rich, and our call-in number is 347-324-3541. Again, that call-in number, 347-324-3541. If this is your first time tuning into My Take Radio, there are a couple of ways that you can enjoy the show. First and foremost, you can watch the video stream on mtrlive.com. There is a tabbed interface on the site allowing you to watch the streams via YouTube Live, StreamUp. In this case, it's going to be Twitch and StreamUp, but you're also able to watch it on YouTube Live, Vaughn Live, Restream, and a host of other video providers. In addition to that, you can listen to the live audio feed on the same web address, mtrlive.com. Just click the audio only tab and obviously mute the other players so you don't get any echoes. In addition to that, you can also listen via the Mixler app available on iOS and Android devices. You can download that by heading to either iTunes or the Google Play Store, looking for Mixler and punching in My Take Radio, and you'll be able to access the show that way. You can stream it to your Bluetooth speakers, listen to it in your car, however you choose. And of course, lastly, you can use our call-in number. Just don't hit option one to enter the queue. You're going to get a lower quality audio feed, but you'll be able to listen to the show that way as well. If this is your first time with MTR as a whole, of course, there is a couple of things that we cover. Wednesday nights, we cover MMA and wrestling. Thursday nights, we do gaming and entertainment. Broadcast time usually is 11 p.m. That's what we try to stick to, except for the last couple of weeks, due to a couple of technical mishaps, but 11 p.m. is our airtime. Usually run about 90 minutes for those of you that want to know the duration. If it's your first time, usually 90-minute show, 2 hours tops. The days of three-hour shows are long behind us. In any case, lots to discuss this week, including the legislation for MMA in New York State. We are going to get into that. We're going to talk about this past weekend's UFC Fight Night event, and the week's MMA news, and of course on the wrestling side, we're going to break down Raw, the build-up to the road to WrestleMania, and of course the wrestling news of the week. And as always, we will take your calls if you choose to participate, 347-324-3541, or you can also participate via the live chat on RageWorks.net. Just go to the live tab there, or mtrlive.com, whichever you prefer. All right, so before we get into tonight's topics, a couple of things I want to get into on the housekeeping side. As many of you know, last week I mentioned an issue going on between YouTube and myself for the My Take Radio TV channel. We received some, you know, copyright information with regards to an episode, I believe it was 232, that they felt used copyrighted material, which obviously we have contested that and we have gone through the proper channels. Currently awaiting the update on that. It's going to take between 10 to 14 days to get a verdict as to what we're going to do going forward on that channel. YouTube has stated that if the copyright holder does not honor the claim or respond to my counterclaim, they will release the video. But I've noticed, and it got me thinking over the last, you know, week or so, that at the end of the day, everything is going under RageWorks. This includes My Take Radio. I mean, I love the My Take Radio TV channel, put a lot of work into it. That was a channel from the old days, from the beginning. Got over 100,000 views on that channel and almost 100 subscribers. And I've been giving it a lot of thought, and I'm thinking that depending on the outcome of, you know, my back and forth with YouTube, I am contemplating sunsetting that channel. For those of you that don't know, I'm planning on deleting it and really just focusing my energies on the RageWorks channel. A couple of reasons. Obviously, we're posting the shows, the video versions of MTR on both channels. And while that is great for those that have been longtime subscribers, it's, you know, it's an additional step in the process. At the end of the day, you guys are either seeing the video on RageWorks.net, or you're watching it via YouTube, or you're consuming it via the live feed. And because of that, I figured, you know, it's extra work. And again, you guys are watching the videos and enjoying them on the RageWorks channel or the My Take Radio channel. It doesn't matter. So, with that said, pending the outcome, well, let me rephrase that. Regardless of the outcome that we get after our, you know, back in discussions with YouTube, my intention is to probably sunset the My Take Radio channel probably by the end of April, first week of May. And I think that it's just easier to do it that way, because we'll be able to, you know, we'll be able to just work on the RageWorks side of things and focus on growing that channel and adding all of our content. Now, what this means, aside from obviously closing down that channel and focusing our efforts on RageWorks, is that a lot of the videos that are there, there really are some really great pieces of video on there. Some event coverage, some blasts from the past, videos that we recorded. I may download some of those and re-upload them to the RageWorks channel. Obviously not the old con footage that we had, even though, you know, it was great footage and it got a lot of great views. It's irrelevant at this time, but the blast from the past and stuff like that, those are older games that still deserve to be spotlighted. And I'm pleased to report that I have actually found a way to bring some of my older consoles down into the studio space, and I may actually start doing more blast from the past videos. Got my, you know, Elgato card down here, got my original Xbox, my PS2, a Dreamcast. So I may actually start tossing in a couple of those old games just for streaming purposes. Haven't really determined a schedule or a course of action yet, but I intend to probably start doing that in the next couple of weeks once we get the wiring done and do some testing. We'll be able to do that. The new monitors that we got actually have a couple of HDMI inputs, which will allow us to work in that environment and do that. So, you know, I'm really pumped for that, and I think it's going to be something that'll be great for you guys. Plus, it's more content on the RageWorks channel. Now, as I said, the My Take Radio channel, we're going to start moving some of the videos over. I am going to record a formal announcement for that channel for the people that are subscribed, as well as those that have been keeping an eye on that channel in addition to the RageWorks channel, much like Slick said in the chat, just to reinforce, you know, subscribe to official RageWorks on YouTube. Again, we're putting all our event coverage there, unboxings, product reviews, game footage. We're definitely going to get more aggressive with that in the coming weeks. And I think that the YouTube thing was, you know, it was an eye-opener for me, only because I've been heavily debating it for quite some time, managing both channels. And I found that it was just too, you know, it was becoming redundant for no apparent reason. A couple of people would message me and be like, yo, did you upload the shows twice? And it was because they had subscribed to both channels. And to those that are subscribed, you know, I appreciate it very much. You know, it definitely means a lot. So if you are a My Take Radio TV subscriber on YouTube, please start moving over to official RageWorks. I will, like I said, put an announcement on that channel with the intention of probably phasing out that channel by the end of April, unless I hear back from YouTube sooner. I mean, if they opt to not, you know, honor my counterclaim, then it is what it is. But I may, like I said, just sunset the channel only because RageWorks is, you know, the parent company of MTR, and it you know, the sole focus should be on that channel. A couple of other things. I know that we were supposed to launch our Batman versus Superman contest. Unfortunately, a couple of things got in the way, namely life. But nonetheless, we are working on it. Hope we may launch it this week and then maybe just have it run through next week, depending on scheduling and also the layout for the contest. As I said, I want to give away all of this stuff in different tiers, first prize, second prize, third prize. But instead of giving both Rock'em Sock'em Robot box sets away via one contest, I may just give one away either on Twitter or Instagram or even on Snapchat, because we are growing on the Snapchat side. Definitely follow RageWorks on Snapchat. We may dedicate one giveaway to that particular avenue, that particular outlet, and then we'll do a more formal contest on the site to give away everything in tiers. As I said, grand prize, Batman versus Superman Rock'em Sock'em Robot set. Second prize is going to be a Batman action figure, and then we're going to have a third prize, which is just, you know, some little tchotchke Batman stuff. Again, that's the tiers that we're going to go in, and you know, keep it locked to RageWorks.net and also our social media accounts for more details for all the contests. Also, Slick has some contests in the bag that he's working on. Hopefully he will have some updates in the next week or so, depending on which items he plans on giving away. Obviously, if we hear anything beforehand, keep it locked, and we will give you info for that as well. The gaming and entertainment edition of MTR that usually airs Thursdays, there may not be a Thursday episode, which means tomorrow, due to some scheduling conflicts, trying to work my way through it and see if we can still put out a show. If not, definitely keep it locked, because we got some great content courtesy of Black is the New Black, Jay Santee's regular season sportscast, and of course the regular season sportscast Overtime, which is a pilot program that we're using for a new show that may be joining the RageWorks network in a couple of weeks. So keep an eye out for that as well. With Jay Santee and Josie's Boy, who have been doing a really good job. Their first TRSS Overtime is doing really well. Positive responses all around. Great feedback from so many people. Shout out to Javon Lewis, who's been a follower of the show for quite some time, for always reaching out to myself and some of the other hosts, expressing the stuff he liked, he didn't like. You know, always very vocal. We always welcome that. We want you guys to share your opinions, let us know what you want to see, what you don't like, what you hope to see in future episodes, and you know, we'll definitely try to accommodate you. On the interview side, I know a lot of people were asking where we're at with Toys and Tech of the Trade. There's actually a bit of a backlog. I have about 5 or 6 people on deck for that, but their schedules haven't permitted, you know, them on completing the questions and forwarding me photos and stuff, but we got a decent crop of really interesting people for Toys and Tech of the Trade, and definitely keep an eye out for that on RageWorks. Also, we are hoping to do some brand new MTR Behind the Mic and MTR Beyond the Mic episodes and interviews. We got a couple of people lined up for that, just have to get the times and schedules in sync so that we can put those out. As always, that stuff, especially all the interviews, will always go to the My Take Radio app first, which you can get for Android, iOS, and Windows mobile devices. It's going to cost you $1.99, but you're going to get 96K stereo episodes of the show, mobile wallpapers, and you will get access to a lot of the content before we release it to the general public. I also want to take a moment and give a shout out to the folks at NYC Pod Meet, the New York City Podcasters Meetup. Had an event yesterday that I had the pleasure of attending. A lot of really great people there. Scott from the Busy Creator Podcast manages it. I give them a hand on the social side. And there were a lot of really great podcasters there, a lot of great talent, and a lot of ideas were exchanged. A lot of stuff was really put together. with regards to that. And you're going to see some of the individuals from that group as well in future episodes of either MTR Behind the Mic or in future Toys and Tech of the Trade columns, only because a lot of our interests mesh together quite well. A lot of really innovative and unique podcasts that are coming out of the Big Apple. So definitely happy to meet those people. And it was really a great event. If you are a podcaster in the New York City area and would like to network and meet with other fellow podcasters, feel free to look up the information on Facebook. There are some links floating around, and I will throw a link for it in the show notes. Again, if you're local, want to link up, get access to some new technologies, meet people that you never know might be the person that's going to edit your audio or be a co-host or be your next guest, definitely feel free to check out the Facebook group and the fan page. And if you have any questions, you can also reach out to me directly, either at RageWorks, Rage_Works on Twitter, or at My Take Radio, whichever you prefer, or of course via email as well. All right, so that's going to wrap up the housekeeping for this episode. We're going to get into MMA. You're going to notice we decided to start changing some of our drops just to keep everything on an even keel. So let's get into this week's MMA, shall we? All right, so I want to start off with the UFC Fight Night card from this past weekend, which was surprisingly solid. I think it was a very underrated card on paper. The main event was Mark Hunt taking on Frank Mir. And the card itself, as I said, had a lot of really great highlights. A couple of fights jumped out to me that I really enjoyed, and I want to get into that. And, you know, there were some fights, you know, I'm guilty of it. I definitely did fast forward to. I did check out Rin Nakai taking on Leslie Smith. Of course, Rin Nakai has an interesting following, to say the least, due to her outside of the octagon activities. Slick can definitely have a few laughs about that. I really thought Rin Nakai was going to come in there and pretty much dominate against Leslie Smith, but Leslie Smith was definitely a gamer. She came in there definitely really aggressive, and it's crazy because, you know, she had an 8-inch height advantage and a 5.5-inch reach advantage on Rin Nakai, and she definitely made use of the height and the reach to really put the pressure on Rin Nakai, especially in the first round. A lot of solid combinations, really good stand-up from her. Second round, I think Rin Nakai kind of started to find her groove, definitely started working on a couple of different submissions. She got a really good arm triangle in on the second round, and again, really, really good work from the top position by Rin Nakai. On the third round, though, Leslie Smith, I think she realized that she may have been down one round due to Rin Nakai's performance in the second, so she definitely stepped it up. The thing was that towards the end of the round, Rin Nakai definitely stepped it up, got a really good position, trying for another arm triangle. Oddly enough, the judges actually gave the fight to Leslie Smith via unanimous decision. The thing was that, you know, the fight, in my opinion, it definitely was Leslie Smith's. Second round, depending on who you spoke to, could have gone either way, only because while Rin Nakai did work a lot of the submissions, Leslie Smith really had a big flurry at one point that really could have given her that round as well. I felt that Rin Nakai had that round only because she had more dominant positions, more submission attempts, and definitely looked like she had Leslie Smith in danger quite a few times during that fight. Now, I did want to talk about the Alan Juban Brendan O'Reilly fight only because Alan Juban was a legit monster. He ended up really working the stand-up. At one point, they got into a collar tie position. Some really nasty, nasty elbows, at which point, you know, Brendan O'Reilly folded up. Juban followed in with a couple of lefts and rights. It was academic from the ride position, and the ref stepped in to stop the fight. Alan Juban took the victory via TKO. Now, the other women's fight on the card was Soo-Hee Ham taking on Beck Rawlings. Of course, Beck Rawlings, very active on social media, contestant on The Ultimate Fighter, known for her crazy tattoos, outspoken personality, and for being a pretty kick-ass mom too. I mean, she definitely is not your average mother. Definitely got some really crazy tattoos. She has like a leopard or a jaguar tattooed on the side of her head. But definitely down to earth, lives and breathes and dies for her kids, and is a fucking hell of a fighter. She went in there taking on Seo Hee Ham, and I'm probably bludgeoning that poor woman's name. And she looked really good, man. She came in. She made the 116-pound weight limit after coming off a very, very bad injury that she was dealing with. You know, I applaud her for not only making a great recovery but showing incredible grit. Ham looked really good in the first round. A lot of solid striking from her. Rawlings definitely was game. She was not playing around, especially in that second round. She really stepped it up. Transitioning into an armbar at one point, really trying to work different aspects of her game throughout the fight, and she really turned it up in the third round. I was impressed, but I also felt that the fight could have gone either way, because I saw that fight twice, and you could have said that Ham took the first and the third, and Rawlings took the second. You could have also said that Rawlings took the second and also took the third. Now, the thing is, of course, they were fighting in Australia, which, you know, home field advantage, it seems a little funky, but like I said, you could watch that fight either way, and the outcome is definitely going to look different, only because, you know, sometimes when you're looking at it from an octagon control standpoint, Seo Hee Ham had a more, you know, she definitely had more octagon control time, but Beck Rawlings showed an incredibly diverse attack, both from standing and ground positions, and I think it was definitely a good outing for her. It's good to see that she got a W back in the column, and we'll see what happens with the next fight. I mean, Beck Rawlings is incredibly marketable. There's a way to market her. You know, like I said, she's a tough mom. You know, that's how a lot of people are looking at her. You know, tough mom. Goes out there, fucking puts on a hell of a show, ready to either stand and bang, take it to the ground, whatever. And I think that was a really good outing for her coming off that injury. Could it have been better? Sure. But it definitely showed that, you know, she's here to stay and that she belongs in the UFC. Now, of course, I did want to talk about the James Tohuna-Steve Boss fight, only because that fight ended in abrupt and disgustingly violent fashion. James Tohuna ended up, they had a little bit of an exchange. There was a slight circle. Tohuna worked a leg kick, I believe, in the beginning. And at one point, he threw a right hand, which missed. And Steve Bose caught him with a short right, and that was a wrap. Dude got folded up via knockout 52 or 53 seconds into the first round. It was definitely crazy, that's for damn sure. Solid highlight reel finish for him, and I definitely applaud that finish. It definitely got a pop when I saw it. I was like, oh shit, that guy's out. You know, it was definitely very cool. I wanted to talk about the Hector Lombard Neil Magny fight. The fight was, of course, had a lot of controversy surrounding it due to the stoppage. Hector Lombard, ranked number 13 at welterweight, taking on Neil Magny, who is on a tear as of late, in the number 9 seed. Now, Hector Lombard, of course, was coming off I believe it was a suspension and an injury, or a suspension only. In any case, Neil Magny had a 9-inch reach advantage, and he definitely used it. And the thing was, Lombard is a big, powerful guy, you know, Olympic level judo practitioner. The guy, you look at him, looks like he's chiseled out of granite, a beast through and through. And the thing is, Neil Magny, wiry, you look at him, you're like, all right, this guy definitely very dangerous on the feet. And I think that Lombard was really trying to work that distance and try and use that and land the big shot, so to speak. And I think that's been something that people talk about Lombard a lot, you know, as a negative, that he always tries to go for the highlight reel finish instead of relying on, you know, his judo skills and don't misunderstand, he had a lot of amazing finishes in Bellator, but it's a different level of competition, not to take anything away from the Bellator fighters, but different level of competition, you know, just a different array of styles. And Lombard, like I said, he looked really good, but by round two, since he's such a muscular guy, obviously you're going to require a lot more oxygen, and you can see that he was definitely getting really, really winded. I thought that he was going to get finished in the second, but we ended up getting a third round, which opened up with Neil Magny breaking a combination out and then transitioning to a jumping knee, at which point there was a clinch, some elbows from Magny, of course, and Lombard took him down, but Magny started working some punches, and when he tried to roll, Neil Magny actually secured a mounted triangle with some hammer fists, at which point the ref stepped in. But the thing was, myself and many other people felt that the way that fight went down in the second round, especially towards the end where Neil Magny was just pummeling on Hector Lombard, pummeling, at which point he had the back position, flattened him out, and he was just legitimately bashing his head in for the remainder of the round. It was nasty. Lombard was trying to defend, but he was getting teed off. You know, a lot of people felt that the stoppage should have occurred in the second round, but, you know, it is what it is. I think that depending on who you ask, some people said it should have gone to the third. Others felt that it should have been stopped given the amount of shots that Lombard took from the ground position. The way I looked at it was, it could have gone either way. If you would have stopped it, there's always the debate that Lombard was still showing signs that he was defending himself. But there was one point where, you know, he was flattened out and he ate a pretty big barrage of punches with no movement from Hector Lombard. If you look for the replay, you'll see that it really didn't go. It shouldn't have gone to a third round. Again, in my opinion, some people feel that the third round was necessary, but considering how the finish went and how easily he dispatched Lombard in the third round, it could have just as easily been ended in the second. Lombard took a lot of nasty punishment. Really, really nasty. I mean, again, it's a great win for Neil Magny. Definitely moves him further up the rankings and puts him on people's radar for a possible title shot. I just feel that for the sake of safety, they could have stopped it in the second, and Lombard couldn't have eaten as many shots as he did. Now, of course, on the heavyweight side of things, the main event of the evening saw the Super Samoan Mark Hunt, ranked number 9 in the heavyweight division, taking on Frank Mir. It's funny that Frank Mir was announced, I believe they said that he was 36 years old, I believe, 36. I'm 35, and I feel like I've been watching Frank Mir fight forever. I looked at it, and I was like, really? Frank Mir's 36? Are you kidding me? And I was like, no. And looks like the dude's 36 years old. I was like, well, fuck. You know, I was surprised with the way this fight went for a few reasons. Frank Mir came in, the cutoff for heavyweight is 265. Mark Hunt came in at 264. Frank Mir came in at 260. Usually Frank Mir comes in around 250 or so, looks pretty shredded, pretty jacked when he came in there. Definitely did not look the part. I don't know if it was an issue with the weight cut, maybe some health problems, maybe an injury. But it definitely wasn't the Frank Mir that we saw that fought, that took on Nogueira, the guy that broke Tim Sylvia's arm. And, you know, this goes back to the old joke that I always say with Joe Rogan saying it's all about which Frank Mir shows up. Definitely not the best Frank Mir that showed up. I thought that he was going to try and take the fight to the ground, considering that Mark Hunt's strength lies with his stand-up. But unfortunately, that wasn't the case. I think Frank Mir was trying to go for the ankle pick on, you know, a couple of occasions, went to the woodshed one time too many. And when they got into a clinch and Hunt broke away, he landed a single right to the temple, and Frank Mir dropped like a sack of potatoes. Of course, Mark Hunt, master of the walk-off knockout, secures the victory, definitely puts himself into some serious title contention and conversation because of this type of highlight reel finish. You know, a lot of people were saying that, oh, Frank Mir should retire, blah, blah, blah. I think that just Frank Mir might have had a tougher weight cut. He might have had a harder camp. Who knows what injuries he was dealing with. But at the end of the day, I felt that, you know, Frank Mir could have actually had a better outing, and he probably could have beaten Hunt only because Mark Hunt is primarily, you know, a standing fighter. There's very little necessity for that guy to go to for that guy to take it to the ground or to even give it any thought, because the guy's punching power is so serious that it's not even a factor for him. You know, he said in plenty of interviews, hey, you know, guys could come in with Brazilian jiu-jitsu black belts, but guess what? I punch you in the face, your black belt doesn't mean anything. And, you know, it's a bit of a boast, but he's right, because it's like if you have that type of stopping power, it's going to take one shot, maybe two at best. And some guys can take it, some guys can't. I mean, Frank Mir is a guy who's taken a lot of punishment, and I didn't think that he would be dispatched with one shot, but it really was a very, very violent shot, because when you see the replay, Frank Mir, it almost looked like he was taking the shot to the back of the head, but when the camera, they did a different camera angle, you see that he's connecting pretty much on the side of the head, temple side, and it was lights out for Frank Mir. And again, I like both fighters. I really didn't want to root against Frank Mir, because I feel Frank Mir is an incredible heavyweight. But Mark Hunt's power could not be denied, and it definitely showed in this fight. Overall, I felt that Fight Night 85 was a solid card. Really, really good stuff from many of the divisions there. The ladies definitely impressed. Obviously, the heavyweights to close it out gave us a highlight reel finish that we can talk about. But I was pleasantly surprised by how good the card was. I was also, you know, really impressed with Neil Magny's striking and the way he approached that fight with Hector Lombard. Like I said, the only blemish for me was that stoppage, which should have definitely happened in the second. Again, that's my take on it. But nonetheless, a solid card. If you can, definitely check it out. See if there's a replay or look for the highlights on YouTube. There, like I said, way too many good fights to not at least give it a watch, even if it's on YouTube for the highlights. All right, so let's talk about this. Let's talk about the MMA news of the week. Obviously, Fight Night bonuses were handed out. $50,000 went to Mark Hunt, Neil Magny, and Fight of the Night went to Jake Matthews and Johnny Case. So each one of those fighters earns a nice $50,000 bonus. There's a big rumor floating around. Numerous MMA sites have been talking about it, and it's the possibility that Cris Cyborg would be fighting at UFC 198, which takes place in Brazil. For those of you that don't know, Cyborg is under contract with Zuffa, and the UFC is looking to really stack that show in Brazil. It's a 40,000-seat soccer stadium, so, you know, you got to make it big, and there is a possibility that we may see her fight. Now, they're looking at options as to whether she's going to fight at 145 or 140, but again, it's something that's not official, kind of been floating around, but people have been talking about it. Cyborg, of course, has been the subject of much conversation over the last couple of years because of the issues she's had with Ronda Rousey and the desire for her to fight her at the 145-pound weight class. Of course, Rousey being the champion dictated the terms at 140. Now, the big question is, all right, you opt to let her fight in the UFC, let's say UFC 198, and you decide to let her fight at 140. The issue with this is that you have now Holly Holm, who is due a rematch, Ronda, who might be due a rematch, and of course, you got Cris Cyborg in the mix, which begs the question, do you have Cris Cyborg fight Miesha Tate and go that route and use that with the winner facing either Ronda or Holly, who I feel, and, you know, we talked about this the week prior, and when Jimbo Slice also agreed when we were discussing it, that Ronda and Holly should fight. The winner will fight Miesha. I think Miesha should fight Cris Cyborg. Cris Cyborg's record speaks for itself. She's a champion in Invicta currently, and I think it would be a very, very, very compelling fight. And the reason I say this and I use that word versus, you know, exciting or anything else, there's a lot going on with those women when you look at it. You got to realize, Miesha Tate and Ronda Rousey have their beef. It's marketable, it sells, but people are tired of it. But you also have Holly Holm, who definitely has a point to prove because, obviously, you know, Miesha Tate beat her with, you know, in pretty decisive fashion via submission. Now, of course, you also have the Ronda factor. Ronda and Cyborg are, even without a belt on the line, it's an incredibly marketable fight. In addition to that, you also have the possibility of putting on a great fight between Cyborg and Holly Holm, two amazing stand-up strikers. Cris Cyborg with the Shootbox Academy comes with that Wanderlei Silva-style striking, and she's a scary, scary woman to watch. In addition, you have Holly Holm, of course, with her very, very, very educated hands. And, you know, there's a lot of compelling and solid fights in the women's division, especially when you're lumping Cyborg into the equation. But again, as I said, we're running the risk of Cyborg not making weight for 140. But I think that putting Cyborg in the mix is going to open up a wealth of exciting fights, and it's going to put the women's division back at the forefront. Obviously, the big thing is getting Ronda in there as soon as possible. And while, yes, we would love to see Ronda be champion because, you know, it's what's, to borrow from WWE, it's what's best for business. The fact is that Ronda and Miesha Tate is not a sellable card. It's not. You can't sell that because either people are going to feel that Ronda's going to walk through her, or they're just not going to be as invested because they don't give a shit about the petty squabbles that both women have with each other as a buildup. Now, in Holly Holm's case, there's a tale of redemption. You know, Holly Holm was defeated after defeating, you know, and breaking Ronda Rousey's undefeated streak. There's a great story there with her and Miesha Tate for the rematch. There's also a great story between Ronda and Holly Holm because, obviously, Ronda wants to get that win back and show that what happened with her was, you know, a fluke, a mistake, whatever the case may be. But there's great storytelling at play with both of those women. Now, again, Cyborg being the X factor, while there is definitely a huge marketing boost if you put her against Ronda, I think putting her in there with Miesha Tate would be very interesting. I hate to say it, but Miesha Tate would probably get destroyed by Cyborg just because Cyborg striking, like I said, that shoot box style, Wanderlei Silva style striking and aggressiveness is not something you see in the octagon currently, especially in the women's division. Closest thing might be, you know, Joanna Jędrzejczyk, JJ, who definitely is incredibly aggressive when she gets in the cage. You know, her fight with Claudia Gadeja, the first fight, and even their stints on The Ultimate Fighter, which I'm hearing were loaded with fisticuffs, were definitely fights, you know, are definitely examples of JJ being a dangerous striker. But I think that as much as people hate to admit it, Cyborg definitely would move the needle. Like I said, one of the premier athletes in the women's division, super dangerous. Great storytelling, like I said, between her and Ronda, if you wanted to go that route, or even putting her in there with Miesha Tate, because Miesha Tate would want to prove that she is the premier athlete in the division and she's the champion for a reason. Again, I do feel that Cyborg would take her out. I don't want to say easily, but I think if it came down to stand-up, she would probably get hurt very, very badly, which, again, no disrespect to Miesha Tate, but I just feel that Cyborg, when it comes to striking, is just a more dangerous opponent for all of these women. But we'll see what happens. UFC 198 is what they're shooting for. You never know. They might go UFC 200. 198 is going down May 14th. Speaking of UFC 200, a lot of fights are rumored to be taking place. Gegard Mousasi may be stepping into the cage to face Derek Brunson. There's also reports that Cain Velasquez will be meeting Travis Brown. UFC 200 goes down July 9th. There's also a rumor, which they're saying actually has bout agreements in place for Conor McGregor to fight Nate Diaz once again. My issue with this is, even though it was a fight that got a lot of people excited, got a lot of people invested, I personally feel as a fan that Conor McGregor should be defending his belt. That's what he should be doing at UFC 200. Whether it's against Frankie Edgar, whether it's against, you know, Jose Aldo, whatever the case may be, he has a belt. He needs to defend it. Now, obviously, the case can be made that, you know, Nate Diaz and him, it's a great fight. People are going to tune in to see it. But here's where I stand. Nate Diaz beat Conor McGregor soundly. There was no sketchy judges, no, you know, one round to this guy, one round to the other guy. He lost. Clear as day. He got choked out, and it was the end of the story. That's it. So to go and give him a rematch with Nate Diaz, for what? If you're putting on an event like UFC 200, the magnitude of UFC 200, what you're going to want to do is get your premier fighters on that card and get your belts defended on that card. You're going for a huge buy rate. The number one UFC pay-per-view of all time was UFC 100. And while, yes, Conor McGregor and Nate Diaz, their pay-per-view came in the number two slot, the fact remains that UFC 200, the marquee event, the name, the one that matters most, should have the most premier athletes and all the belts on the line. Or at least most of them. Like, if you wanted to do Rafael Dos Anjos, Nate Diaz for the title, you could do that. You can throw Jose Aldo in with Conor McGregor or Frankie Edgar. You could do that. Maybe we could see the return of GSP. You want to put him in there with Robbie Lawler, which is what their rumor, what the rumors are cranking out. Sure, why not? But at the end of the day, you're putting together the fights that are going to make people invested from bell to bell. You know, you could go with the Octagon debut of CM Punk as your opener. You could do that. There's a lot of stuff at play here, and the fact is that to give us a rematch from a fight that there was nothing, you know, there was nothing on the line, doesn't make any sense to me. If anything, you should take Nate Diaz, reward him, and let him fight Rafael Dos Anjos for the belt. Plain as day, simple as that. No necessity to go into this long, lengthy, oh, you know, the fight was the number two selling fight of all time. We all understand that it's about money. But when it comes down to your marquee event, your WrestleMania, so to speak, you want to give us the most compelling matches possible. I like Cain Velasquez, but nobody's going to give a shit about Cain Velasquez and Travis Brown. Even though I like Cain, I think he's great, no one's going to care. Gegard Mousasi, Derek Brunson, why? Unless you're doing it on the prelims, no one's going to care. There's you have to have, you know, UFC, GSP's return to the cage, promising. McGregor and Aldo, or McGregor and Edgar, boom, you got another one. Nate Diaz maybe taking out Rafael Dos Anjos, boom, you got another one if he's ready by UFC 200. You know, you have ample opportunities to create something amazing and legendary, and instead, you're going for the easy money. And even Nate Diaz has gone on record. He's like, oh man, do I really need to fight this dude again? And that's not taking anything away from Nate Diaz, because guess what? Everyone asked that question. Yo, does that fight really need to happen? And honestly, I think that it doesn't. It doesn't need to happen. Conor McGregor needs to defend his belt, and he should do it at UFC 200. Simple as that. All right, so on the Bellator side of things, you guys know that Ken Shamrock and Kimbo Slice tested positive for banned substances after their Bellator 149 fights. I almost said UFC 149. The funny thing is that both guys tested positive for the same steroid. Shamrock also tested positive for a synthetic opioid, methadone. Which, you know, if you lived in the New York area, you know, and you were in the hood, you know about methadone clinics, which were used to treat heroin addictions, which is a huge red flag. In addition to that, obviously, they had elevated testosterone to epitestosterone levels. Shamrock's was 12.4 to 1, and Kimbo Slice was 6.4 to 1. The Texas Commission allows a 4 to 1 ratio. Both men, of course, face a $5,000 suspension, or they could reach a settlement by March 31st, which would allow them to settle for $3,000 and a license revocation. Again, both fighters testing positive for performance-enhancing drugs. The thing that jumps out to me, more so than the steroids, like I said, was Ken Shamrock testing positive for methadone. That's some scary shit. I don't want to presume that Ken Shamrock has a heroin problem, but methadone is unless somebody can let me know what other uses there are for methadone other than drug addiction, please let me know, because reading that is some scary stuff. Especially, like I said, I grew up watching Ken Shamrock fight. I watched him transition from the Octagon to the WWF at the time. Back to the UFC, back Bellator, Strikeforce. He's been all over the place. The guy is, a pioneer in the sport, and I really hope that the methadone showing up in his system isn't part of a bigger problem. Slick just informed me that methadone is also used for pain maintenance and therapy. Interesting. I don't know, man. That's I don't know. It's again big red flag. I'm gonna definitely do a little bit more research, find out what the story is, and if we get anything else related to this, I really will make it a point to share it with you guys. Like I said, very scary to see that as a drug test, on a drug test for a guy like Ken Shamrock. That's all I'm saying. Anyway. The Daniel Cormier-Jon Jones light heavyweight title fight is quickly approaching. Of course, the hype machine is in full effect. Jon Jones is in the news this week for something else, which I'll get into later on in the segment. But the card with him and Daniel Cormier squaring off is taking shape quite well. Demetrius Johnson, Henry Cejudo are squaring off for the flyweight title. Edson Barboza is taking on Anthony Showtime Pettis. Rafael Sapo Natal is taking on Robert Whittaker, and Andre Feely is taking on Yair Rodriguez. Also, Anthony Pettis' little brother will be fighting on the prelims, and we are also seeing the return of Juliana Lima to the octagon. So, definitely a solid fight. Jones and Cormier, there's a lot of bad blood. Many of us are expecting a war, and I really would like it to go that route, and I'd like it to for both guys to leave it in the cage, only because you don't want it to end in some, some sketchy decision. You want it to be decisive. The bad blood between these guys makes it necessary that there has to be a clear winner. Whether it's knockout, TKO, or submission, there needs to be a clear winner, only because, nothing else would suffice to eat. Nothing else would be able to quench the ego of either one of these guys except a dominant performance. So really looking forward to it. Of course, the build-up I'm going to try and share as much as I can on RageWorks.net and on the show. And of course, when the fight comes up, you will also get our fight picks as well. I'm actually really excited to talk about this next Bellator card, which is going down April 22nd in Connecticut, because it's the Benson Henderson debut in Bellator, taking on Andrei Kurashkov for the welterweight title. Also, Patricio Pitbull will be taking on John Teixeira. And there's also a feature bout with Evangelista Cyborg Santos, formerly married to Cris Cyborg, taking on Brennan Ward. Evangelista Cyborg is a scary dude, man. You watch him go in there and he is a scary guy. This card, like I said, is on my radar because I'm curious to see if Benson Henderson can come in and kind of upset the establishment and capture the welterweight title in his first fight in the organization. That alone is incentive to watch. Benson Henderson is a guy who's had plenty of fight of the nights, incredibly agile, super explosive, exciting to watch. And I think that, for him to come into Bellator fresh off his UFC run and win a title is something that's worth exploring. That's for sure. All right, so the big story, of course, is you know, New York State finally is on the verge of mixed martial arts becoming legal in the state. The New York State Assembly has passed a law legalizing MMA with a bipartisan vote of 113 to 25. Of course, even though the vote has passed, it still has to be signed by Governor Mario Cuomo, which of course, Mario's his father, Andrew Cuomo. Jesus, way to date myself. Nothing bad, though, I gotta say. His dad wasn't a bad governor, that's for sure. But Governor Andrew Cuomo will be signing that. And, you know, I'm really excited as a fan, as somebody who covers the sport and has been watching this for quite some time. You know, New York has kind of been the redheaded stepchild when it comes to mixed martial arts. Whenever an event is held in Jersey, all the special stuff is done in New York City. Anything and everything, whether it's, you know, open workouts, whatever the case, media days. And as a fan, I just feel it's been, you know, a long time coming. And it's funny because I was, we were at the New York City podcast meetup, and I saw somebody send me a screen cap of Dana White's Twitter and Instagram, and it was pretty much a map of the United States, and it was all red. And when you scroll up on the photo, New York State is red now with a smiley face. And when I read that, I was like, wow. I'm like, did it finally happen? And of course, sure enough, it did. A lot of jubilation and excitement from many of the fighters, many of the mixed martial artists here in New York City, New York State area. And I'm really pumped, man. As a fan, you look forward to things like this, not just because of the UFC, because yes, the UFC is going to come into New York and they're going to make a complete spectacle. You know, whether it's taking over Madison Square Garden, taking over the Barclays or Nassau Coliseum, whatever the case may be, the UFC is going to come in and do something big, huge, and monstrous for their debut in New York State. But in addition to that, it is also opening up the gates for companies like Bellator, which holds events in Connecticut and in some of the other, you know, local areas in the surrounding New York. And to see Bellator or World Series of Fighting or RFA or any of these other promotions actually be able to hold events, whether it's, like I said, the Barclays in Brooklyn or Nassau Coliseum in Long Island or the Mecca, Madison Square Garden, is huge. Yes, as a mixed martial arts fan, you know, I'd love to be able to go and see a UFC event and sit there and experience it and be part of history. But I'm also aware of the fact that, you know, an event in Madison Square Garden is going to cost a metric fuck ton of money. But as someone who covers the sport, who does their best to, you know, educate and give you guys the as much insight into the sport as possible, whether you're an existing fan, someone who casually watches, or are someone who is brand new to the sport, the fact is that as an outlet, as someone who does this, I'm really excited to be able to, you know, go to an open workout in the city or go to a weigh-in and be able to share that experience with you guys through my eyes as a fan, as somebody who's local here in New York City. You know, that alone is part of my excitement for this. Of course, being able to see it in my own backyard is a plus as well. And like I said, it's not just the UFC. There's tons of other promotions, Bellator, RFA, like I said, Legacy Fighting Championships. There's so many smaller organizations that can come in, put on amazing fights, and we'll be able to enjoy them just the same now, thanks to the State Assembly ruling MMA, you know, in favor of MMA with such a huge, huge margin. Of course, as I said, Andrew Cuomo is going to be signing the bill. The Athletic Commission has 120 days to adopt guidelines, which the UFC will, of course, and other organizations will abide by, with the target date as of this show being November for the UFC to hold an event in Madison Square Garden. Their goal, according to Lorenzo Fertitta, is to do at minimum two events in New York City before the 2016 comes to a close. So there you have it, ladies and gents. Mixed martial arts is a go in New York State. As I said, I'm really excited. A lot of New York-based fighters really taking to social media. Ray Longo School put out a really cool video with Chris Weidman and Matt Serra, Aljamain Sterling, and all those guys. They were just really excited. And of course, as I said, you got a lot of local guys in the mix, guys like Chris Weidman or even Jon Jones, who's from upstate New York, that are really excited to go in there and represent for the Big Apple. I think it's huge. And when the UFC comes into New York in November, it's another history-making moment for not only them as an organization, but for the sport as a whole. Because like I said, once they come in and kick that door open, we're going to see other promotions come in and put on shows, and we'll be able to check them out and report on them and be cage side or be at a weigh-in. So like I said, as somebody who covers this, I'm really excited, not as a journalist, never a journalist, as someone who covers it and shares opinions on it, I am really, really, really pumped. And like I said, it's something that we're definitely going to be reporting more on over the coming weeks. And once those events start taking shape, of course, we're going to make it a point to let you guys know about it. That's for damn sure. Last two bits of news to wrap things up. Jon Jones, of course, we talked about him getting into some legal trouble not that long ago, being caught speeding, doing 75 in a 35 mile per hour zone, didn't have a license, didn't have registration, didn't have proof of insurance. I'm sure Dana White was biting every nail on his hand, scared that this would escalate to something bigger. Turned out that he's avoiding serious trouble due to those traffic violations. It turns out he was able to provide paperwork proving that he was licensed, registered, and insured. In addition to that, he made a $100 donation to a New Mexico Animal Humane Society in good faith gesture as part of the deal. He is clear of any charges as long as he stays out of legal trouble for the next 90 days. Of course, Jones scheduled to face Daniel Cormier later on in April, April 23rd for UFC 197. Again, Jon Jones got a break there. I mean, he had all the documentation, dodged a bullet, but I'm sure the UFC was sweating heavily waiting for that to pan out. But again, with that behind him, we can move forward to UFC 197 in April. Last bit of news, Ken Shamrock and Kimbo Slice were not the only fighters that were testing positive for drugs this week. And turns out that Diego Brandao, who has been a longtime performer in the UFC, received a temporary suspension by the Nevada State Athletic Commission after he failed a drug test at UFC 195. Turns out he tested positive for marijuana metabolites. Even though he lost during his fight with Brian Ortega, he is under temporary suspension due to the level of metabolites in his system. They're saying that he exceeded the WADA limit of 180 and the NAC limit of 150. The outcome of his suspension obviously will be reported in the coming weeks, and I will share that with you guys. Again, you know, my thoughts on marijuana when it comes to the UFC, I've talked about it at length. You know, this guy's going to be suspended. He might, you know, get a year or two, depending on how the commission feels that day. We know how it's been handled with guys like Nick Diaz. I believe Diego Brandao, this might be his first offense. So, you know, he might just have to eat a little fine, maybe a 90-day suspension, unless they want to get aggressive and go for a year to set a, to make an example of him. We shall see what happens. In any case, that bit of news is going to wrap things up on the MMA side. So with that, let us switch gears and jump into the wrestling news of the week. So let's get to it. All right, so I got to start with Monday Night Raw. I'm not 100% sure I want to keep that bell for both transitions, mostly because it fits more with MMA than wrestling. I mean, wrestling has a bell too, but we'll see what happens. Work in progress. Anyway, the road to WrestleMania, of course, continues. We had Monday Night Raw this past Monday, and there were some highs and lows. A couple of things I felt were really well executed, and a couple of things that needed some work. I mean, the opening promo with Stephanie McMahon and Roman Reigns was it was solid. I mean, it was good. I think Roman Reigns is starting to develop a little better. But again, you just see that nobody's into Roman Reigns. Nobody's digging the character. Nobody feels any sort of connection. I mean, you hear some cheers. It's not on a Cena level, but giving it enough time, it'll definitely become It's definitely going to get into Cena territory, but the hate isn't going to be because it's trendy. It's just going to be because people don't really like what they're doing with Roman Reigns. And no fault of his own. Like I said, the guy goes out there, he's punching the clock and doing what he's got to do. But I really feel that WWE creative and management should take a step back and realize that they're just creating a blueprint for failure for this guy. And it's unfortunate because I think that if you're trying to create this guy as your star of the future, you're not giving him the ample tools to go out there and get over with the fans. Like I said, his weaknesses are incredibly apparent when he's out there with most individuals on the microphone. And, you know, his ring work has improved, but he's definitely working the atypical WWE five moves of doom style that we all know and love all too well. But again, solid opener to get the ball rolling. Kevin Owens took on AJ Styles, and really, really, really beautiful match between these guys. You know what the thing was? When we got this match on SmackDown, there was no fanfare. It was like, oh yeah, AJ Styles, Kevin Owens. This is, you know, WrestleMania level. This is pay-per-view quality wrestling between these two individuals. And to see it out there, obviously, you know, AJ Styles' dance card is full with Chris Jericho, but the fact is that the match was beautiful. There was such great wrestling between both individuals, an incredible amount of storytelling and athleticism on display. But also the fact that the chemistry was just there. Here are two guys, they cut their teeth on the independence. Here they are on the main stage, showing off, giving us great wrestling. And like I said, the match was really, really good. The crowd was into it. And, you know, Chris Jericho's involvement, while it was there, it definitely didn't, you know, it wasn't bad, you know. On top of that, obviously, the continued buildup with Kevin Owens and his title match at WrestleMania, which, of course, we find out later on in the evening, is going to be a ladder match with him, The Miz, Sami Zayn, and the rest of the participants from a triple threat match that occurs later on in the evening, which I will address. Again, it's one of those things where I knew that was pretty much the outcome only because they're really trying to stack the card, give everybody a WrestleMania payday. It was really a no-brainer that it was going to go that way, and sure enough, it did. Big E and Rusev squared off, and of course, this is going to be the continuing trend all the way to WrestleMania, since we know that the League of Nations will be squaring off against the soon-to-be face New Day. And the way I felt, I think that it was a good big, you know, a good big man match. You can see that Big E is just a better wrestler. There's definitely a lot more, there's definitely a lot more with Big E as a performer, and I'm hoping that WWE, whether it's 6 months or a year from now, realize the gem, the untapped potential that Big E has as a performer. He, you know, he's got good mic presence, he's funny, he can take a joke, he can also be part of a joke, and you know, he's just an incredible presence. And I think that if you leverage that, you can create that quote-unquote African-American performer that can get to the main stage and, you know, cross over. And I think Big E is definitely the guy. Not to take anything away from Rusev, I think Rusev was, Rusev is a solid performer. He's definitely gotten in better conditioning. He's gotten a grasp on his conditioning. He looks in better shape, I think partially because he's marrying Lana and he wants to look good on his wedding day. But whatever the motivator is and whatever's getting Rusev in shape, definitely keep doing it. It looked, you know, a guy definitely is moving better, working really good in the match with Big E. Like I said, a great big man match. I just feel that if you wanted to do something with, do something down the road with Rusev, you're only going to be able to use him as a heel. Like, he doesn't resonate with anyone as a face unless you completely drop the Russian gimmick and you go in a completely separate direction. You know, the guy is your foreign big guy, and he's kind of pigeonholed in that, you know, in that role for the foreseeable future. But again, really good match. We got the Hall of Fame announcement that Stan Hansen is going in there, which is awesome. I think Stan Hansen should have been in there a long time ago. I heard he is actually going to be inducted by Vader which is equally cool just because I'm a big Vader fan, and anytime he's on TV, it's definitely worth checking out, that's for sure. We had a Fandango sighting. He took on Chris Jericho in a match that nobody gave a shit about, including yours truly. We had a match for a contender to face Kevin Owens at WrestleMania. It was Stardust, Zack Ryder, and Sin Cara. Of course, you know, there was a DQ. Everybody started beating up Kevin Owens, including the individuals I mentioned earlier, and these three individuals. So, of course, Kevin Owens goes backstage, starts bitching, starts complaining. Next thing you know, it turns into a ladder match with, like I said, Sami Zayn, The Miz, Dolph Ziggler, now including Stardust, Zack Ryder, and Sin Cara. Definitely great for Zack Ryder, you know, getting a WrestleMania opportunity. Good for Sin Cara as well. I mean, we know Kalisto has his hands full with Ryback at WrestleMania, but it's good to see Sin Cara hasn't been cast to the side and has an opportunity to show something unique at WrestleMania. And I think the ladder match is tailor-made for him to do something awesome. I mean, you know, it makes you wonder, and I'm going to be honest when I say this, if Neville wasn't hurt, would Zack Ryder still be in this match? I'm being honest. I mean, you saw that Neville and Sami Zayn were beating up Kevin Owens, you know, a couple weeks back, and then, of course, Neville got hurt. But I'm wondering, you know, did Zack Ryder's fortunes change because Neville is injured? Because, honestly, when you look at the participants in this match, you'd expect Neville to be a shoe-in, but obviously not. So, I mean, it's a great opportunity for Ryder. It's a great opportunity for Stardust and Sin Cara as well. But, you know, would any of those guys, I focus primarily on Ryder because, you know, that guy, he's been relegated to NXT tag team status. And with that, you know, he doesn't really get too much airtime except for occasionally main event. Mostly it's just NXT stuff. So, I mean, it's a blessing and a curse. You know, it's sad that Neville got hurt, but it's an opportunity for one of these guys to have a better showing at WrestleMania and perhaps get an increased role in television programming going forward. We'll see what happens, but I'm sure that ladder match is going to have a ton of great spots. A lot of incredible performers are involved, and it's one of the matches I am definitely looking forward to. Charlotte and Natalya was essentially the run back from Roadblock. It is what it is. You know, Bubba Ray and R-Truth was another forgettable match. And the last match of the night was Ambrose, Braun Strowman. Everything that happened after Raw was just a complete disaster. But the you know, the match was what you'd expect, typical big man, little man match. Braun Strowman trying to overpower Ambrose. Ambrose goes crazy, starts wailing on him with chairs. The crowd was super against it. There was even a point where there was a "this is boring" chant. And I hate to agree with them, but it really was a terrible match. It shows that Braun Strowman just sucks all the excitement out of a room. He is, you know, he has an incredible presence. He's just not, you know, he's not a dude that should be main eventing Raw so close to WrestleMania. I hate to say it, but it's true. You know, it was an interesting match. You know, Paul Heyman on commentary was really good, but, you know, it was a match that did not need to happen on the road to WrestleMania and to get the bigger ratings boost. I mean, Dean Ambrose is going to make anybody look good, but Braun Strowman, I don't care what anybody says, just incredibly green, and he didn't look good out there. I hate to say it, but he definitely did not. So, after Raw was over, of course, we had a dark match, which it was pretty much kryptonite for everybody involved. First of all, Luke Harper got hurt. People are saying that he suffered a knee injury during the match, and you know, hopefully it's nothing too serious, but that's another big blow to the WWE roster, because Luke Harper's a good worker, definitely leaps and bounds better than Braun Strowman, and to find out that he's hurt, it's like it couldn't have come at a worse time. In addition to that, and this was really crazy, and I had to actually do some fishing around to see this, a fan actually struck Braun Strowman in the face during the main event. There's a point where Braun Strowman falls to the floor to sell, you know, the offense of the match, and the fan actually sticks his hand and hits him in the face. And, you know, Braun Strowman, again, whether he sucks as a wrestler or not, he is a massive human being. He can probably beat you to death with minimal effort. And he ended up pointing the fan out to security, and the fan was removed. And, you know, after the incidents with people jumping the railing and becoming involved in WWE matches, WWE said that they were going to be go after anybody and everybody that would put their performers at risk. So this guy, you know, he probably thought, oh man, if I could hit him, you know, that would be pretty fucking cool. And it was cool, but not in a good way. Now this guy probably going to get brought up on serious charges, and is probably going to be banned from the building. For what? You know, maybe for your 15 minutes of fame, for putting your hands on a pro wrestler who is capable of beating you to death. I mean, you know, it's like those instances where, you know, people try to pick fights with the Big Show. Why would you do it? Why? Regardless of whether the guy can hit you or not, or you think you could take him, why do it to yourself? Why put yourself out there? But, you know, I gotta commend Strowman for being a professional, not jumping the railing and killing the guy, because, you know, that's the thing that comes to mind first. But, you know, the person was removed, and like I said, Harper suffered an injury. It was just a bad night from the dark match perspective. Hopefully, like I said, Harper just tweaked his knee, didn't hurt himself too serious. We'll find out probably over the weekend the extent of the injury, and of course, I will let you guys know next week. The next WWE NXT event is starting to really take shape with an incredible amount of awesome matches, and I'm really seeing some title changes on the horizon. Of course, Shinsuke Nakamura making his debut, taking on Sami Zayn, pumped for that. Austin Aries taking on Baron Corbin, of course, A-double. The greatest man that ever lived, now in NXT. I think he's going to get a really good match out of Baron Corbin, and I think he is going to have a memorable debut. Also, tag team championships are on the line with the Revival taking on American Alpha. Team Angle 2.0 continues to improve every week. Chad Gable, definitely, that guy has all the potential. He legitimately, and this is no bullshit, he is the second coming of Kurt Angle. You watch this guy move in the ring, and you will see just so many throwbacks to when young Kurt Angle debuted in the WWE and just amazed us with stellar ring work and really solid entertainment across the board. I think him and Jason Jordan are stellar together, and I hope that they keep them together for the foreseeable future, not only in NXT, but hopefully in the main roster as well. I think they have that it factor, that magic that'll really, really resonate with the fans. It'll connect because you can see it. You see it in their promos. You see it in their entrance. You see the fact that the crowd is super into their characters. I think it's a step in the right direction. And I think we're only scratching the surface with American Alpha. That's for sure. You know? The other match, of course, and this was a no-brainer, Bayley taking on Asuka. And I think we may finally see the Bayley title change, and I think we may be seeing Bayley getting the call up to the main roster. I think putting the belt on Asuka is a great step in that direction. I think that as a performer, she has all the tools in the ring. Obviously, the command of the English language needs a little work, but again, we're looking at it from a strictly wrestling perspective, and sometimes you could just remedy that with a manager. Smart money is on, like I said, them putting the belt on Asuka and then transitioning Bayley to the main roster, or perhaps Bayley heel turn. Never know. But I think as over as Bayley is, especially in NXT, you don't want to do that. But if they are going to do something big, I think putting the belt on Asuka and maybe having Bayley debut on the main roster is a step in the right direction. And of course, Finn Balor, Samoa Joe is your main event NXT title. I see a title change here. I see Samoa Joe getting the belt, Balor heading up to the main roster along with the soon-to-debut Bullet Club or whatever they're going to be called on the main roster, and that's going to be that. I think it's a great transition. I think moving the belt from Balor to Samoa Joe is a smart move. Balor is, you know, not getting any younger, and I think WWE wants to maximize his exposure on the main roster, and this is as good a time as any to transition him up and put that belt on him. I think Samoa Joe is a great guy to carry the belt in NXT. He has the look. He has the presentation, and he can wrestle his ass off. So, not only that, but, you know, Samoa Joe Austin Aries match is definitely not a bad way to go down the road. That's for sure. The other big wrestling news this week, of course, was the rumors that Sting was going to retire due to the neck injuries that he sustained in his match with Seth Rollins. Even though TMZ has said and alluded to the fact that Sting was going to retire, Sting actually did dispute that and said that he was not prepared to announce his retirement. Their side, his side, and the truth, but until WWE puts out an official statement that Sting, aka Steve Borden, is retiring, we're going to take it as it is. You know, he got injured. They told him what the injuries were, and that's it. Who knows? He may receive his induction into the Hall of Fame and take that opportunity while he does the speech to announce that he is retiring from active competition. That may be the icing on the cake. A lot of people are saying that that's pretty much why he hasn't confirmed it, because he's going to do it formally at the Hall of Fame ceremony. We'll see what happens when the Hall of Fame ceremony goes down. Either way, Sting gave his body to this business. I mean, this guy was the flag bearer of WCW pretty much for the majority of the early goings. And even during the Monday Night Wars, when he transitioned into the Crow Sting gimmick, he was still a driving force on the programming, whether it was mixing it up with the NWO or being part of the NWO with the Red and Black. At the end of the day, Sting pretty much was the guy who led the charge for WCW when other guys came and went. Sting was WCW through and through. He bled that organization. And to see him go into Hall of Fame is awesome. Unfortunately, not sure what the story is with his neck, but if he is able to wrestle one more match, it would be a disservice to him to not let him have that match with The Undertaker. It's the match the fans want to see. Excuse me. It's the fans the match the fans want to see, on top of the fact that I think the build-up and even the match itself, we're not expecting a five-star Matt Classic here, ladies and gentlemen. And with that, I think that, you know, you got to accept it for what it is. It'll be an attraction match, a sideshow match, and it will be a great opportunity. I mean, I'm curious as to where they're going to go with The Undertaker's character, because Vince McMahon said that if Shane McMahon won, you'd never see The Undertaker ever again. I mean, is that the blueprint that's been laid out for The Undertaker to retire? You know, I found it very interesting that Vince added that stipulation on Monday. And, many of us talked about it, but I said to myself, maybe this is the blueprint that they're laying out to allow him to retire, or at minimum, maybe set up the possibility of him and Sting down the road with, one last match between them. I mean, like I said, Sting said that, you know, my neck is okay. I'm not officially retired. There's a lot of rumors out there, but I'm not officially retired. He told that to TMZ, and again, he may be saving the big announcement for the Hall of Fame ceremony, but we're just going to have to wait and see. I did want to talk about the Ultimate Warrior Award, which the Wrestling Observer newsletter is saying that they're going to give it to Joan London. Joan London was the host of Good Morning America, was a cancer survivor, and she's been working with WWE and Komen for the Cure to increase breast cancer awareness. I think she is definitely a great candidate for the award. And, hopefully this year, and I've kind of been back and forth on it, we may work with Komen for the Cure once again. Once there's further details with regards to that, I will share it with you guys. Don't expect to hear anything concrete until the end of August, early September at best. And if we do, of course, I will make sure to let you guys know as well. We got some TNA departures that I want to talk about, and these are some biggies. Both Bobby Roode and Eric Young are wrapping up with TNA. It seems that both gentlemen were asking for raises. Turns out that they did not get them, allegedly, and they just took that opportunity to announce their exit from the company. Now, a lot of people are saying that it may be because they're going to head up to WWE, maybe NXT, and we may be seeing them in the future. Again, take that with a grain of salt. I think Bobby Roode would be an incredible asset to WWE and NXT. Eric Young is a solid wrestler. I don't know how well he'd connect with the WWE audience, only because it's very easy to typecast him in the dumb, crazy guy gimmick like Eugene or some of these other throwaway characters. But you never know. I think EY, he's done really well as the world-class maniac, you know, with that persona on TNA, you know, in TNA programming, has done fairly well. I'm curious to see how it would transition to the WWE, but I think Bobby Roode, he has the look, he has the wrestling, and definitely has the chops to make an impact in WWE and NXT especially. So we're going to be monitoring this very, very carefully, and we'll see what happens. I think both guys would be great assets to the company, and I knew it was inevitable that they would depart only because TNA is in a really weird restructuring period, and much like AJ Styles, when he asked for more money and TNA didn't, you know, do him the solid, you know, I think more and more TNA originals are going to start stepping out the door in the future if this trend continues. But I wish them luck. Like I said, I hope to see them in NXT or even WWE programming in the future. And, you know, keep it locked to MTR and RageWorks, and we will report on any developments that happen. The other big news story, of course, Hulk Hogan pretty much obliterating Gawker for the trial with the sex tape. You know, I haven't been talking about it too much only because the ongoing litigation has been, it's been tedious. But I gotta say this, it takes a badass fucking dude to sit in a courtroom with a do-rag on like Hulk Hogan does. He straight up is sitting there with a rag on his head like nothing, like it's part of his ensemble. He's like, yo, it's like suit, tie, dress shoes, do-rag, ready to go. It's the craziest thing to see that. But, yeah, it turns out that Hulk Hogan, he not only got them for $115 million from Gawker, he is also getting $25 million in punitive damages. The $25 million includes $10 million from Nick Denton, who owns the media outlet for Gawker, and also another additional $15 million from Gawker himself, plus $100,000 from AJ Delario, who was the editor-in-chief at the time that the clip from the sex tape with Hogan and Heather Klem was published on the site. Obviously, there's going to be some appeals. Gawker has already stated that they intend on appealing, and the appeal could be much more favorable to them than the initial lawsuit, obviously, because it would allow them to whittle that down. But there were over 1,000 pages of previously sealed documents that weren't able to be shown to the jury that may have suggested that Hogan was aware that he was being filmed. They are also saying that Bubba told the FBI while they were investigating an extortion on Hogan that the WWE star did know that he was being filmed. There's, you know, text messages, a whole bunch of stuff. So I think that Gawker is definitely going to appeal in the hopes of unsealing those documents and showing them either to the a new jury or to the general public. Either way, you know, I really find it difficult to believe that, not so much that Hulk Hogan knew or didn't know that he was being filmed, but the fact that a media outlet like Gawker, which again is a pretty big outlet, would put themselves out there and show that sex tape, especially if it was stolen or allegedly put out there, you gotta question the logic in that. In, you know, in 2016, especially after all the countless celebrity nude photo hacks that have occurred, you gotta understand that the minute you opt to air something so personal to the general public like that, you run the risk of putting yourself in deep shit. And the problem is exactly that. You know, Hulk Hogan, he didn't, even if he filmed the tape, even if Bubba Clem was in a closet cranking one off while he was videotaping them, you know, Hogan plowing his wife, the fact is that I sincerely doubt that Hogan said, hey, release that to the general public. You know, that's one of those things that, again, whether consenting adults agreed to it or not, the folks at Gawker should have done their due diligence and found out where that tape came from, and whether it was an authorized copy that got out, which we all know it wasn't. But you got to remember, even though Gawker is a big outlet, there, you know, you're not talking Bloomberg or Huffington Post. I mean, you're a big outlet, but not that big. And the thing is that people are saying that they could be forced to pay three times that, which would be an additional $345 million, which the grand total, when it's all said and done, may be $460 million. I mean, that's enough to tank a company very, very easily. As I said, there's still a lot of stuff going on with regards to documentation, text messages, and a host of other things that were sealed. But who knows? Like I said, Heather Klem allegedly said that she knew she was being filmed, but she said otherwise in sworn testimony. So there's a lot of stuff that's still raising a lot of red flags. But I'll be honest, Hulk Hogan winning, I think, you know, if he legitimately had no idea he was being filmed and this was put out there, I mean, this was one of those instances where it damaged his career substantially. I mean, this was even before, you know, him making the racial comments that he made. This definitely was the beginning of the end for his career, and it was definitely a huge blemish on, you know, on an otherwise spotless and immaculate reputation for the Hulkster, especially in the mainstream media. Obviously, we all know him as, you know, a huckster, a charlatan, whatever the case may be, depending on who you ask. But the fact is that if the guy genuinely didn't know that he was being filmed, and Bubba the Love Sponge took it upon himself to do that and did not destroy or secure that tape accordingly and it got out, I mean, I gotta be honest, he's just as easily to blame as anybody else. But to play devil's advocate, I gotta say this, Hogan, you know, doesn't it strike you odd that your buddy would say, hey, you know, it's hey, why don't you come over, have a few drinks, fuck my wife, you know, how does that happen? You know what I mean? Like how do you wake up, and I'm being honest, like, how do you consciously just be like, yo, you know, come over, have a couple beers, we'll watch Sports Center, my wife will come in, you go in the broom, pound her out, I take some video, yeah, it's all good, you know, we're all friends here. Like, how does that work? How does that really work? And I'm being, you know, I'm joking about it, but I'm also being serious. Like, think about it. You're Bubba the Love Sponge. This is your wife. This is a person who, you know, you took vows with and all this shit, you know, sanctity of marriage, however you want to view it. And you're going to genuinely sit there and have a guy who is better looking than you, not by a lot, but still better shape, pound out your wife, and you're going to watch it. Obviously, you know, it's the old cuckold, you know, dynamic, which I've talked about previously. But again, like it's just, there's so many red flags here. Like I said, for Hogan, if Hogan genuinely didn't know he was being filmed, then he deserved the settlement because, like I said, this damaged his career immensely. I mean, not as much as, you know, him, you know, making racially insensitive commentary, but it definitely did him no favors. And Gawker, as a media outlet, you gotta have the safeguards in place. You gotta have all the legal safeguards in place now. Again, playing devil's advocate, if they have documentation that states that Hogan knew he was being filmed, you know, they may have an out to shrink the payoff, but they definitely still gotta pay Hogan money because, again, even if Hogan actively knew he was being filmed, he didn't sign anywhere for that tape to be released to the general public. He didn't send it to Vivid Video or any of these other outlets. He, you know, it was just a tape that was made. And, you know, it makes me wonder, if he didn't know that he was being filmed, did Bubba want to save that tape for a rainy day, for blackmail or anything else? Who the fuck knows? But again, even if Hogan willingly knew he was being filmed, again, if he knew that, Gawker put themselves on the hook releasing that tape to the public. And yes, they may not end up having to pay $115 million or $460, but they're going to have to pay something because, again, there's breach there. And, you know, they're going to have to divulge how they got that tape in the first place. And that, my friends, is going to be very, very, very interesting Because depending on how they obtained that tape and who they got it from is going to paint a very different picture. So, again, you know, I'm kind of happy for Hogan. He needed to catch a break. Again, the racial stuff wasn't cool. I'm not condoning that. But the guy hasn't been doing well. And regardless of, like I said, whether he consciously knew he was being filmed or not, I sincerely doubt that he said it was cool for you to put that tape on some sort of a website. You know, it does not make sense to me. That's all I'm saying. Anyway, we're going to be watching this very closely, especially with regards to Gawker's appeal. And, you know, obviously any updates, we will be ready to share them with you guys. Last bit of news to wrap things up. While Eric Young and Bobby Roode are departing TNA, two former NXT talents are scheduled to be joining the company in the future. Marcus Louis and Sylvester Lefort allegedly signed with TNA shortly after working a dark match with the company. That's what's being said. It looks like they will be debuting on TNA TV in a couple of weeks. I didn't really have anything negative to say about either one of those guys, Lefort or Marcus Louis. I think they worked well as, you know, the foreign tag team, and that was fine. Not sure how they're going to fit into TNA or if they're going to run with the same pro-French, you know, foreign villain dynamic that they did. But we'll see what happens. I mean, those guys weren't terrible wrestlers. And, you know, the NXT training facility did a good job on those guys. So we'll see what happens. The other thing I did want to mention, another former NXT talent found a new home as well. Solomon Crow, a.k.a. Sami Callihan, is rumored to have signed with Lucha Underground for season 3. And, you know, that's going to be good. I think his character, his look is tailor-made for an organization like Lucha Underground. I think he will thrive there and do very well. Really looking forward to seeing that. I mean, Lucha Underground has been killing it lately. Rey Mysterio, of course, debuted in the latest episode. If you didn't watch it, you should. And, he, you know, Lucha Underground is kicking ass, man. Some of the best wrestling and storytelling in the game is happening in a small upstart promotion on a network by Robert Rodriguez, who himself is an upstart and, you know, a rabble-rouser and a troublemaker. Definitely very cool. Looking forward to seeing Callahan's debut in Lucha Underground Season 3. Also looking forward to seeing Marcus Louis and Sylvester Lefort's debuts in TNA. All right, so that bit of wrestling news is actually going to wrap up the wrestling segment, and with that, let's close out the show, shall we? I've given you guys my take on MMA and wrestling this week. As always, I would love to hear yours. Feel free to reach out on social media, either on Twitter, at MyTakeRadio, or Rage_Works, or if you're on Facebook, join our fan page, facebook.com/officialRageWorks, or check out our Facebook group, either way. And you can interact with the rest of the RageWorks and MTR team and some of the other listeners as well. We do contests. We talk about some of the other stuff that we don't mention on air, you know, certain matches, angles, things like that. Big pop culture events, all that stuff goes down on our group page and, of course, on our fan page. It gives you immediate access to all of our content and also our contests as well. So you can look for that as on Facebook, either as a group, the RageWorks group, or as the fan page. You can also find RageWorks on Instagram. You can also find us on Snapchat, Google+, and Pinterest. We even got a couple of Pinterest boards with a couple of things that we like to share. Articles, cool art, wrestling, different things. Look for that as well. Access to this show, archived versions, will be available in 24 to 48 hours of airing. Video archives, of course, can be found on our YouTube channel, Official RageWorks. As I said at the start of the show, we intend to sunset, i.e. delete, the My Take Radio TV YouTube channel in a couple of weeks. The goal is probably end of April, at which point then RageWorks, Official RageWorks, will be the main channel going forward. So keep an eye out for that. Of course, we will be putting a video on that channel advising subscribers and viewers there of our intentions, but the main goal is to have the RageWorks YouTube channel be the main channel going forward. Audio versions will be available on iTunes, Stitcher, and TuneIn Radio. We are still working on our debuts on Google Play and Spotify as well. Keep an eye out for that. As soon as that goes live, we will let you guys know that as well. Lastly, as always, the best MTR experience is on the My Take Radio app, available for Android, iOS, Windows mobile devices, high-quality audio, 96K stereo. You're going to get access to mobile wallpapers, exclusive content that airs on the app first before the general public, including MTR Behind the Mic, MTR Beyond the Mic, the Minority Film Report, which I wanted to bring it back for Deadpool, but it looks like we may be using it for Batman vs. Superman, Dawn of Justice. We'll see what happens. Speaking of, obviously, keep an eye out for our Dawn of Justice announcement in the coming days. Hopefully, it'll go live, if not Friday, sometime over the weekend, and we'll run through the following week. Lastly, there might be a little bit of a schedule change for the Gaming and Entertainment edition of MTR, which airs Thursday, which as of 35 minutes into midnight is today. In any case, keep an eye out on social media if we opt to air a Thursday show. If not, I will see you guys next Wednesday at 11 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m. Pacific, to break down all the happenings in MMA and wrestling. Thank you guys for your continued support. As always, thank you guys for tuning in. On behalf of myself and the rest of the crew, I am out of here. Peace.